All right, a warning to all of you watching right now. I'm about to say a word that might make you furious. Millennial. I know it sounds so innocent, but it provokes so much resentment and a lot of mockery like this.
Hey.
Hi.
I think you're cute.
You do?
Yeah, I'm looking at a picture of you and it's really hot.
Oh my God, you just faved it? This is moving too fast. I mean, I don't even know how I identify.
Well, I identify as gay, but I only sleep with women.
That's very brave. I'm just gender lazy.
Okay, we can hate them, but why do we hate all millennials? Writers at SNL have some fun with that, but listen to a real-life scenario. The Monterey Biscuits, they're a minor league baseball team, and they're hosting their own Millennial Night. They tweeted this out. Want free things without doing much work? Well, you're in luck. Riverwalk Stadium will be millennial-friendly on Saturday, July 21st, with the participation ribbon giveaway just for showing up, napping, and even selfie stations, along with lots of avocados. So they're having some fun with it. A little insult to injury here, though. They misspelled millennial on their ticket site. You know, a lot of people seem to just hate millennials, but do they even know who they actually are? According to Pew Research Center, a millennial is anyone born between 1981 and 1996. I mean, that means you can be 36 years old and be a millennial. Now, on the other end, you're 22, right? But as we all know, 36-year-olds, they usually care about paying their mortgage and taking care of their kids than they do avocado toast and selfies. So why all the hate? Opinion Nation, I want to hear from you. Why do people hate on millennials so much? And bringing in to talk about it, Gus Portello, he's a millennial. And he was late, which I attribute to you being a millennial. I'm just kidding. He's also a Republican strategist and executive director of Accuracy in Media. Ben Kissel is a millennial on the later end. Ben, I'll give you that. Also a podcaster, radio host, and political commentator. And then Pete Dominic, you're just old. You're no millennial, but you're here to give us some perspective. I'm not a millennial either, so I'm with you on this. You're also a Sirius XM talk show host. Gus, I want to start with you. Why do you think all the hate?
Well, I think we've been giving a little bit of heat just because of, you know, the general perception that, you know, just millennials are lazy, that they're not as hardworking perhaps as prior generations, generations like our parents' generation. But I think it's a little too harsh because, you know, you have to understand the general basics of this generation. One, it's the most indebted generation than ever before, but at the same time, it's the most entrepreneurial generation. More and more and more young people of my age, in my generation, really are starting businesses and are not afraid to go out there and take risks and in attempt to change really their lives by starting a business. So I think we've been giving a bad rap, but I don't necessarily think one person defines an entire generation.
Well, and Pete, look at the millennials, the Parkland shooting survivors. I mean, they've been out there. They're able to elicit change we haven't seen after any school shooting. They have a voice. People listen.
Yeah, I was talking to one of those young people at one of those rallies, and I said, what do you say to people, old people like me, who say, you're going to get jaded and bitter when you fail after a year at this. What do you say to us? And he looked me right in the eye and he said, I say, watch me. And I am watching them, and they're amazing. And this idea of generalizing about a generation that is still coming up is preposterous. If anything, it's fair to generalize about those generations that are already done living. And my generation, my parents and my grandparents, we did a lot of good things, but we did a lot of horrific things. Let's start with the Vietnam War. We can talk about the economic collapse of 2008. And of course, climate change. We're giving our kids and their kids a planet that they might not be able to live comfortably in. So there's a lot more blame to go around for older people who have, by the way, saddled this generation with amazing levels of debt. And that's who I'd like to impugn during this segment in any opportunity I get, Lynn.
And, Ben, when you hear Pete talk about some of those things, it's actually why some millennials say that they're so focused on giving back. Even companies realize they have to change their advertising to millennials. What do we do that gives back to the world, gives back to the community?
Right. Yeah, I mean, millennials right now, recent studies have shown from the Harvard Business Review, for example, that millennials across the world tend to work more hours than their older counterparts. In the United States, it's roughly 45 hours per week for less pay. So that whole thing that the biscuits threw out there being like, want something for free, you don't got to work for it, come to watch this game. It's a total lie. And the irony, of course, is if it wasn't for millennials, there would be no one in the stands for the biscuits games because the field, the diamond, would be be empty. It's all millennials playing. Maybe there's a coach on the sidelines channeling his inner Tom Hanks from A League of Their Own, bitter, disgruntled, and drunk. Who knows? But millennials have proven time and time again to be the most agile, the most intelligent generation when it comes to navigating this new world that, quite frankly, our parents and the older generations didn't help us out at all with.
Okay, guests, we're giving you plenty of love. All of you millennials out there, you got plenty of love. Let me give the other argument here. And I've had this happen even in the workplace. I've had these people come in, 21, 22 years old, and they'd be like, oh, I want to be on TV like you. How do I get on TV? And I want to say to them, I was a secretary for like 5 years. I was filing papers and setting lunches before I even was in the vicinity of getting to where I am. It's almost like they don't have the concept of how long it takes to accomplish something.
Well, but they're children, so of course they don't when it comes to the younger millennials. And at least it's good that they're motivated to get on television as opposed to someone who just says, oh, I want to hang out in my parents' basement, play video games, which, by the way, can be a very lucrative profession now as well if you go on Twitch and things like that. So at least they're motivated to want to have your job because you're doing wonderful and your profession is awesome.
Well, motivated is great, and that's wonderful. But, Pete, when it comes to things like if I was asked by my boss to do something, I was like, oh, I have to go get coffee or I have to file this or file that. I was like, absolutely. I was the first one to get there, last one to leave. It just doesn't seem that there's that same kind of motivation for success in that way.
It's so easy to cherry pick that kind of attitude, that kind of behavior, especially in the business that we're in, Lynn, in television and radio and broadcasting. The fact of the matter is every one of these kids has a camera. We like to make fun of them for being so selfish. Oh, look at their selfies. I'm pretty sure if the World War II generation had cameras, they would have taken pictures of themselves as well on selfie sticks. They just didn't have them. Things change, technology moves, and attitudes change as well. I always applaud somebody who's eager and ambitious, but maybe, Lynn, you should be like me. Haze them and then fire them.
No, I can't do that. But I might make him get coffee. No, just because I'm still bitter having to do that for 5 years.
Give them an opportunity.
Yeah. You know, Ben, I have to ask you, though, you know, when you think about, you're sort of on the end of it. You're 36 years old. Could it be a misperception of what a millennial is? I know that you're probably worried about your mortgage.
Well, not quite yet. I'm worried about going to the Borgata Casino in Atlantic City this weekend. But, of course, the millennial, when you think about that age group, absolutely. LeBron James, for example, is a millennial. Steph Curry, if you wanted to do away with all millennials, the only basketball player we'd be seeing is Vince Carter. So we are everywhere, and it really is a disservice to the hardworking people of this country who are desperately trying to pay off their student loan debts and make this country what it should be, prosperous as possible.
Well, maybe it's more of our responsibility as parents to try and teach these millennials to put down their devices. Pete, I'll go to you for that.
Absolutely. Blame the parents every time. Blame the parents. Blame these kids is preposterous. Blame the generations ahead of them. Yes, we have to do better with our kids. We know better, and we have to provide opportunity, help create that work ethic, and so many other things as parents. It's preposterous. You know, I'll add Mark Zuckerberg and Kylie Jenner. I mean, these are important people. They're innovative people. They're taking advantage of what opportunities they've been given and creating other opportunities. But yeah, it absolutely starts with the parents, and it starts with an opportunity for an education more than anything else. And now these kids, including maybe Ben and our other panelists, are paying back student loans. I was lucky. Daddy paid for my college. But that is preposterous that people in their late 30s and early 40s are still paying for college.
Well, and here's what's different, Pete. It probably cost a lot less for you to go to college when you were going through. I mean, I think about my parents. It was like 10 grand for me to go to a state school. It's $65,000 now for some of these kids to go to schools. I mean, Gus, do you think that this is going to make them enter the workplace and have them elicit some change when it comes to the generation that's coming behind them?
Definitely. I mean, look, these prices are not going to stop, and they're not going to get any lower anytime soon. I think it's important that, you know, Pete was mentioning, you know, it's incumbent upon the parent to really elicit some, or I guess instruct some change into their children in this generation. This generation is also going to be the most powerful generation, arguably, yet, you know, in terms of in enacting change. You know, some of my friends here have mentioned that, you know, some of these guys have been so important in instrumenting change towards gun legislation. You know, it's important that they continue to be involved like that to be able to enact some change in terms of our education and making sure that it is affordable for, you know, future generations to be able to get an education as well.
Gus, Ben, yeah. Pete, sorry, one last word, Pete.
Well, yeah, well, I might as well make it that I really appreciate you overestimating the high-quality university I attended.
Gus, Ben, and Pete, thank you so much. I'm always going to give you the benefit of the doubt. I do appreciate it, you guys.